All right. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. It's so good to have you with us. And this is the last webinar of this series. So far, we had a great time with all the speakers. And I'm very excited for this session because this is the session in which we are going to talk about designing a product, not just on the design side, but on the manufacturing side also. And today, we have a special guest with us. He's Debashish. Debashish works as a great industry professional. And he's also very active on YouTube, right? And he's a very active person on Instructables. He makes content specifically for green energy and sustainable energy. So welcome, Debashish. So good to have you with us.
Thank you, Varun, and thank you, Autodesk Fusion 360, for providing me an opportunity to present on this webinar. I welcome to the Autodesk Fusion 360 webinar series. And thank you joining for this webinar on design of a DIY solar lamp.
I'm sure it's going to be awesome, man.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So before moving to the designing part of the solar lamp, let's see the outline of webinar. And in this webinar, we will basically go from the scratch to design of the solar lamp. The main function will be the main thing will be the component of the solar lamp design approach, controller design in Autodesk Eagle. I will cover the schematic and PCB designing part. After designing of the PCB, we will go through the prototyping and testing part. And after making the PCB, the enclosure design by Fusion 360 will be covered by Varun. And at the last, we will discuss the question and answer. About me. I am an electrical engineer. My name is Debashish Dutta. By profession, I am a power engineer. And by passion, I am a DIY hobbyist or master. I pursue my electronic hobby during the night time and weekend. I run my YouTube channel, Open Green Energy. I am an active author of Instructables. My area of interest. Basically, my interest is on renewable energy and sustainability. As for that, I have given the channel name Open Green Energy. The Open stands for open source and green energy for renewable energy. Apart from the electronics, I have interest in 3D printing, woodworking, and making crafts from household stuff. And apart from electronics, 3D printing, and woodworking, I have another interest that is collecting the coins. I am a registered member of Delhi Numismatic Society. My maker journey. So, from my childhood, I have interest in making small projects by using household stuff. But whenever I completed my matriculation and entered into the higher secondary, I did not get enough time to pursue my electronic hobby. So, I completely detached from hobby. And after completion of my BTA, and whenever I joined in a day job, I started my journey again. I pursued the electronics hobby. And to start the electronics hobby again, I searched through the internet for a simple LED project. Accidentally, I found a 8x8x8 LED cube on YouTube, and it was run by Arduino. And you cannot believe, I did not sleep few days just before making that particular LED. I can show you that LED or now it is visible.
It's good now.
You can see this is the LED cube what I have seen on YouTube, and I have gone through the details of this instructable and finally, I made it. After making this LED cube, I got enough confidence on electronics and Arduino. And
how much time it took you to make it?
I think it is around 7 to 8 days. But I
so
cannot.
Much soldering, man.
Yeah. And if anyone new to electronics, I will definitely recommend to make a LED cube. You will get enough confidence on electronics as well as soldering parts. So it is definitely recommendable. after that, actually, I thought I have enough confidence to make electronic products. So I take knowledge from YouTube and Instructables. And you cannot believe, I observe around 1 to 1.5 years just different Instructable writing styles, how the pictures are taken, how the things are written properly so that the viewer or reader can easily understand. And after 1.5 years, I first got an Instructable on an energy meter. And fortunately, I was the winner list. So, which was actually the big boost inside me. And after that, I never left electronic hobby. And from that day, I started first Instructable. And YouTube is just a byproduct of Instructable. In the beginning time, I posted YouTube video only to show my demo for the functionality of working project.
Right.
And later on in the year 2016, I actually created a good video on YouTube. That's my journey. And the challenging part for the electronics hobby, right, for making Instructable or a YouTube video is getting new ideas. It is really difficult. If you want to maintain the consistency for writing Instructable and YouTube videos or uploading YouTube videos, you require new ideas. And in the short duration, it is very difficult to get new ideas. And the next challenge is making the ideas into fully functional projects, consistency in uploading the videos. And you cannot believe how much time it requires to edit a video. For a 5 minute video, I spent around 7 to 8 hours for editing only. It is huge. And my achievement, till now, I have 92K plus subscribers on YouTube. I have published 92 videos. And in Instructable, I have published 53 Instructables and 126 Instructables. That's all,
and
I think.
And I have visited your Instructables also. And I noticed the reach of your channel on the page. Can you just show that?
Sure. Definitely, I will show you. Just a minute.
Maybe I shift the bucket.
Got it. No problem.
So 7 days to edit a video, or how much time it takes to make it, like record it?
Recording time is not much more, but getting idea and making it into a functional prototype is the main time taking process, and next time taking process is the editing process. That's all.
Right.
You can see my Instructable profile page.
What caught my attention was when I saw you got like almost 9 million views. And I saw all the medals in your belt.
You can see it.
Right.
Thank you, Varun.
You won everything.
Thank you. And you can see most of my projects are on renewable energy and waste material stuff like that. And a few of the projects are included 3D printed parts like this one, and this one. And this particular project is very popular on the web. And the PCB and full enclosure already available in this Instructable, and the enclosure 3D printed part or the .stl file is available on Thingiverse account. I will share the Thingiverse account later. And you can also see my YouTube channel. This is my YouTube channel.
You know, Deva, when I saw that video of the mini fridge, I used to watch that like a couple of years back. I think 2 years back, this one, DIY portable mini refrigerator.
And I
could never imagine, you know, like somebody, you know, living in the same city made this video, and it had got like almost 2 million views so far. It's a very good one.
Thank you, Varun. Sorry, Varun, I have written here 53 Instructables, but fortunately I have written more than that.
Nice.
54 Instructables, actually. I should share the story why I have designed this solar lamp. In the year 2015, I was visited to my village neighbor house. So I was really shocked by seeing this scene. You can see how the school going child is reading and the cooking is taking place. The lamp they are using is kerosene lamp, which is producing the harmful smoke, and it is very dangerous because it can catch fire, which is really hazardous. So immediately I thought I should at least make some alternative option for these people. So whenever I came back to my working place, I started on designing this solar lamp, and within few weeks I make a prototype for this solar lamp. You can see the image. You can see this image. But this is the prototype what I have made 4 years back. So after making this prototype successful, I have distributed few of my prototype to the village people so that they will get benefited from that. This is the story behind why I have designed this solar lamp. So this is my inspiration. You can see this screen. And the most advantageous part of this solar lamp will decrease the amount of local air pollution as well as save lot of energy. Then we will go to the component of the solar lamp. The solar lamp is nothing but a standalone photovoltaic system. If you clearly understand the solar lamp design, then I can guarantee you will definitely design a off-grid solar system for your home also. So the basic component of the solar lamp is solar panel, controller, battery, and LED. The solar panel is convert solar energy or light energy into electricity, and that electrical energy is stored in a battery, and the charging part will be taken care of by the controller. The controller also drives the LED. The LED will produce the desired light output. Design requirements. There are two design requirements for making a product. This is the first part is the electrical design requirement, and next is the mechanical design requirement. In this webinar, we will discuss both the parts. In the electrical design requirement, we will select the component and design the PCB schematic in advance. In the mechanical design requirement, Varun will cover how a 3D printer custom enclosure is made for this solar lamp PCB. Before diving into the solar lamp design part, we should understand few basics on light and electricity. Lumen is total amount of light emitted from a light source in all direction is known as lumen. If we consider a considerable area, the amount of light falling on that considerable area is lux. The relationship between the lux and lumen is 1 lux is equal to 1 lumen per meter square. So coming to the basic electricity rule, everyone I think know about the Ohm's law, that is voltage is equal to current into resistance, power is equal to voltage into current, and energy equals to power into time in hour. Then before moving to the design part, first we have to set the goal. As per the international standard of light, the minimum requirement of lux level for a general purpose use is 150 lux. So by taking small a margin, I am taking it as a 160 lux. So our design goal is to be making a lamp that can produce 160 lux of light. The light source to be selected in accordingly. Then whenever we talk about lux, we have to fix the surface area. In this design, I have considered a reading lamp, sorry, reading area that is 1 feet into 2 feet, that is coming around 0.1885 meter square. Then we will calculate the lumen. Lumen equals to lux level into area, that is coming around 30 lumen. So we have to design the electrical components accordingly, which can produce 30 lumens of output. By searching in the internet and market, I have selected this 8mm 0.5 watt per head LED. If you go to the data sheet, you can see the amount of light the LED produces 50 lumen, and our requirement is 30 lumen. So I think this LED is perfect to this lamp. Then LED power consumption. So as per the data sheet, you can see 50 lumen is equivalent to 0.5 watt. So I have calculated the LED power consumption is coming around 0.3 watt. LED voltage and current. So in order to design a LED circuit, the main parameter is LED voltage and current. The forward voltage for this LED is 2.8 volt to 3.2 volt and current requirement is maximum 150 milliampere. Selection of battery. We have two type of battery available in the option. One is AA nickel metal hydride or nickel cadmium battery. Another one is 3.7 volt lithium ion battery. By considering the availability and safety, I am taking this AA nickel metal hydride battery as the reference. Then battery sizing. So before sizing the battery, we should understand the energy flow diagram. You can see the energy flow diagram. The LED is connected to a LED driver and LED driver is connected to battery. The LED driver is required to provide constant current to the LED. And if you go to the LED power calculation, you can see the power consumed by the LED is 0.3 watts and I am considering for a backup time of 4 hours. So the energy requirement at the LED input could be 0.3 watt into 4 hours, that is 1.2 watt hour. The LED driver is not 100% efficient, so we have to consider the efficiency of the LED driver. So by considering the LED driver efficiency, the energy input at the LED driver should be 1.43 watt hour. And it is a good practice to not discharge the battery fully by taking battery life into the consideration. So here we have considered to discharge the battery up to 80%. The battery depth of discharge is 80%. So the energy stored or energy required for storing the battery should be 1.43 divided by 0.8, that is coming around 1.78 watt hour. Here the AA battery voltage is 1.2 volt. So the battery capacity required is equal to 1.78 watt hour divided by battery voltage, which is coming around 1490 milliampere hour. If we go for the nearest value, that is 1500 mAh. So our battery selection is fixed. We will use a AA nickel metal hydride battery with a capacity of 1500 mAh. As I have already discussed for the battery selection, the similar session we will calculate the solar panel sizing also. You can see the energy flow diagram. The battery is charged from the solar panel via a controller. Controller is nothing but the same driver circuit. So I have already calculated the battery size, which is 1500 milliampere hour. So the energy required for this battery to charge is 1.8 watt hour. As the controller is 84% efficient, so I need more energy at the input side of the controller, which will be coming around 2.14 watt hour. And coming to the solar panel sizing, we should know something. The solar panel is rated for standard temperature test condition. So which is around 25 degrees centigrade and 1000 watts per meter square solar irradiance. But throughout the day, you cannot get this parameter. So the effective sun hour we have taken here is 5 hours. It varies according to the location of the place. Now we can see the energy required for the solar panel equals to the battery capacity divided by the controller efficiency. Solar panel what I have fixed. If for solar panel, then the watt hour is divided by effective sun hour, that is 5 hours. The solar panel power is 0.428. Then I searched for the nearest value of solar panel available in the market and I found 0.45 watts. So to charge the battery, 1.2 volt battery, we need a solar panel which is higher value than that of the battery voltage. So the nearest value available in the solar panel is 2 volt to 2.5 volt. And I think for 1.2 volt, 2 volt to 2.5 volt is the more adequate solar panel. So I am here selecting 2 volt as the solar panel back voltage. So to find out the current value, I divide the watt divided by solar panel voltage, that is 225 milliampere. Now our solar panel is fixed, that is 0.45 watt. And 2 volt to 225 milliampere. And okay.
Just a quick one. As you just mentioned, the battery voltage is 1.2 volt and the power solar panel of a capacity of almost twice the value, right?
No, not exactly, Varun, true wise. Actually, what happens throughout the day, the sunlight is varies. So, if I select the battery voltage value very near to the solar panel voltage, then the battery most of the time will keep idle. So, the solar panel voltage must be slightly higher than that of the battery voltage. Right. As per my experience, it is 2 volt to 2.5 volt solar panel is perfect for a 1.2 volt AA battery charging.
Right. And how much does it cost, like if you think of getting a 2
volt? If we purchase a single unit, it will be cost around, I think, 80 to 90 rupees. But if you purchase in bulk, then it will be coming around 50 to 60 rupees only.
But 90 rupee, like if I get on to get like 1 watt of power, right?
Yeah.
I have to invest like approximately 180 to 200 rupees, which is not bad.
Yeah. Definitely, it is not bad. Then come to the controller selection. The controller has two tasks. First is charging the battery. For charging the battery, there are two main functionalities. First, isolate the solar panel when the battery is fully charged. Otherwise, the battery will damage. And isolate the load when the battery is discharged. In both the cases, considering the battery health, this functionality is given. You can consider it as a protection also. And then next task of the controller is to drive the LED. All the LED runs successfully whenever it gets adequate amount of voltage and current. In our case, the voltage requirement is 3.2 volts. So, the driver has a capacity or capability to boost the battery voltage to the LED operating voltage. The battery voltage here is 1.2 volts and we require 3.2 volts. This is the main functionality of the driver circuit, which will boost 1.2 volt to 3.2 volt. And by considering this input, I have selected a driver that is QS5252X. It comes in different packages. I have selected the SOHOL type packages, that is CO94 package. And this is perfectly fit to our project. And you cannot believe the cost of the driver is only 2 to 3 rupees only. So these are the few parameters for the driver circuit. The operating voltage is 0.9 volt to 1.5 volt and output current is 3 milliampere to 300 milliampere. In our requirement is 93.7 milliampere. It is perfect. And whenever the driver is in ideal condition, it consumes only 17 microampere of current. And I have left one main thing. For this driver circuit design, you only require a single external component, that is inductor. If you select the inductor, then the circuit is complete. You don't worry about anything. These are the four pins of the driver IC. That is, first pin is solar battery, that is the solar panel positive terminal connection. Second one is battery connection. And third one is common ground. And third, last one is LED output terminal. This is a reference design given in the data sheet. You can see this is the IC, this is the battery, and these are the two LED. In our project, I have only used one LED. And this is the solar panel and this is the battery, and these are the two LED. In our project, I am only using one LED, that is the 0.5 watt. Type LED. So I have to select only one component, that is the inductor. To find out the inductor values, we can use the datasheet formula. But there is another option. The datasheet have given a ready reference table. From the table, you can select the inductor value. In our case, the current requirement is coming around 97 milliampere. So I am taking some margin, I select this 110 milliampere. So to achieve the 110 milliampere output, we need a inductor of 33 microhenry inductor. Now all the parameters are fixed. We have to make an electrical design.
Hey, Devashish, a quick one. You mentioned about the inductor. Can you maybe showcase something like why we need the inductor in this design?
Normally, if you need a boost circuit, normal in a buck converter or boost, basically this is a boost converter circuit. So definitely, and where there is a controlling of current come into the picture, then you definitely need a inductor. But normally what happens, if you select a driver, the manufacturer itself recommend what are the external component required here. So it is not my own choice. It is recommended as per the manufacturer data sheet. So only one thing I in my hand is to select the value of that inductor. And I have already shown how I have arrived this RTC in UI.
Sure.
So let me show the Eagle schematic first. I have drawn this schematic on Autodesk Eagle, but you can see these are the three terminals. These are the two pin headers for solar panel, battery and LED. And this is the only external component, that is 33 μH inductor, and this is the driver circuit, driver IC used in this project. Now we can switch to the board. Before moving to board, I can show you another few things. So whenever I normally design a product, first I design the electrical circuit. After completion of the design, completion of the schematic design, I usually test the circuit on a grid board. You can see the image. I made the circuit on a breadboard and test the output on my DSO. After completion of fully functional breadboard test, you can go for prototyping. I made the prototype on a perforated board. This is the same prototype which I was already discussed in my first slide. Now we can move to the PCB design part. From the schematic in the Autodesk Eagle, from the schematic you can directly switch to port. I should mention one thing here. As I have already familiar with Eagle, so I have used Eagle for designing the PCB, but now you can design the PCB on Fusion 360 also. After designing the PCB, you can push this reference design for enclosure design by clicking on Fusion 360. And the enclosure design part will be covered by Varun later. So after completion of the PCB designing, the next work is to generate the curve file. You can see here in the file option, the file option, there is a option generate CAM data. You can click on OK. It will produce a zip folder containing different type of file. Basically there are three files. One is Curve file, assembly file and view file. All these files are contained in a zip file, and you can use this Curve file for making the real PCB. You can order the PCB by using all these website like JLC PCB or PCBWay or OSS Spark. And a good option in Eagle is that you can generate the VOM also. If we go to the ULP, there is an option on export bill of material. If you click on that, I have already taken a screenshot. You can see here. These are the VOM required for assembling the PCB. Now I can play a video. Though I have designed this PCB just few days before, and before that I have already made this circuit on another PCB. You can see the prototype testing. I am holding this PCB in front of book. It is the distance between the book and the light is around 1 feet, and you can see the amount of light is adequate for reading purposes. And the same circuit is also used in any other applications like making solar garden light or messenger light. You can see this video. The next part is, next duty of the Autodesk Eagle is that you can put the PCB design into the Fusion 360, where you can design your custom enclosure. The custom enclosure part will be covered by Varun. Hi Varun, can you take?
Yeah, thank you so much Devashish. All right, moving forward, I just want to show everybody where we are right now. I'm going to first put this everything in my offline cache, so I don't have to struggle with the connectivity, right? I need this, I also need this battery holder and this power LED, right? So if you see, change a couple of things, right? So if you see, this is the same PCB that was designed by Devashish, right? So this is exactly what we were working on. And as Devashish is very comfortable on working on Eagle, you know, we all have our expertise in certain things, but just to make sure Fusion also has this feature. So Eagle is actually integrated into Fusion Electronics workspace. So in case you want to make a PCB, this is also possible right there, right? So once we have a PCB like this, that the task is to make the good looking enclosure that we can also 3D print and use it at our homes, right? So for this, I created this enclosure, right? So I'll just quickly demonstrate what I did. And let me quickly hide what's, so this is the cover. All right, there we go. Let me hide this LED. So as you see, this is the PCB. I made this small enclosure. This is the battery holder. And you see, these are the small collars to hold the nuts and bolts in place. Let me show this. If you see this, and I made this small pyramid kind of shape for a good reflector to hold the LED in place. And this design also has all sort of tolerances, so it doesn't take me too much time. It's just a work of, like, you know, 40 minutes to 1 hour, right? Entire 100% thing. So I'll quickly model this again, like something similar, right? Because I know this is like still work in progress, and I was supposed to add this solar panel at the bottom. These four screws also works as a small holder so that the reflector doesn't get distorted because of the dust particles. So you can just tilt this piece down like this. You can just keep this in under the sunlight so it will charge. And then there is also a small clearance in the body, so the solar panel does not touch on the base surface when you keep it upside down like that, right? So that's the design. And I'm going to quickly model this again just to show you how it works and how to take it forward, right? So I'm going to create a new design in my Fusion workspace. And I'll I'll just save this. I'll just press my commands S button. I'll say test design for awesome participants. There we go. And now we have to first import this PCB, which is the most important thing right now for us. So I just clicked on import into current design. There we go. And now I'll click OK. Everything is good. I want this battery holder also. We got this. There we go. And I also need this power LED. That's it. And these are the small components we have. We also had one more component, which was the small on-off switch, but I'm not considering that right now because this is still possible right here. And we still have a limited time, so I have to finish this ASAP, right? So first thing first, what I do is I just place all the components in their actual place, right? I want my design to be minimal, but I don't want it to be very, very small so it keeps on wobbling on the table. Like, I wanted this design to be used as a torchlight from the side portion, or people can keep it like on the table so we can have a good overhead lighting in the room, or we can have it like a focus beam at certain point, the sideways. What I'm going to do is first I'll place my objects, right? This is some very weird place. So I want this to be somewhere here. I click OK. I'll move it again. Okay, we want this to be 90 degrees, and this way it is supposed to be minus 90, right? Like this. We don't want to play with LED right now. I'm going to hide this. There we go. We have these two things. And now I'm going to create a new sketch. And this is going to be, okay, I have to go to my home view. There we go. Now we have to create a new sketch, and I want the bottom plane, this plane, right? And I'll make a new rectangle like this. And I wanted the design to be square in shape. So 80 by 80 seems like a reasonably good number, but let's say 100 by 100, right? Something like this. And the approach I follow is sometimes it can be a square. It can be, you see in my original design, it was actually somewhat like a bit curvy in shape. So I added splines in this design, right? So we can do it like many ways. So just for the sake of reference design, I'm going to make it more simplistic so everybody understands, right? I'm going to use extrude command by pressing E, and I just quickly extrude that, this thing. And I want it to be at a height of approximately 80 millimeters. That is 8 centimeter. This is the stuff. I'll make it a new component, right? I don't like creating too many bodies. I want my design to be more structured. So I make always make new component for specific purposes. This looks pretty good. Now I'm going to use my fillet command to, I don't want all the four edges. I just want my side edge to have a curvy look, right? And I'll make it like approximately 10. Not bad. Maybe make it 15. Let's see. Better. Okay, we have this, and this is a solid block. We want to have some room inside. I'm making it for 3D printing, and usually for 3D printing, we have the nozzle of 0.4 mm diameter, right? So there's a nozzle thickness of a 3D printer. I want to make a design in which we don't have to create too many infills. So suppose if I have to 3D print, I want to make it something like which can be easily printed in less time and more efficiency. So the golden rule of thumb I follow is I make my wall thicknesses as a multiple of the extruder thickness, right? So if it is 0.4, I'm going to make it 1.6, right? So this way my printer will make like four lines, book, 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 and then it will be a solid wall. So we don't have to do like infill and all those things. It's a super quick, super easy trick, and it really, really works for designing objects for 3D printing. I click all right. This is good. Now we have a pretty decent looking enclosure, and we have to fit all these components right inside this. So one way could be, because these are all components, I'm going to rename this lower enclosure. I go to assemble. This is my joint. I'll click joint. Okay, I have to hide this for some time. So remember, when we have assemblies, this is component one and component two. This means one is from, two is to. So first component will move to the second component. So make sure whichever component you want to move has to be selected as one, right? So I want this lamp battery holder to move to somewhere on the center of this, right? Okay. Let's say this thing. Okay, I clicked the wrong object. I have to do it again. I do this, center. There we go. And now obviously we don't want this battery holder to go out of this the box, so it has to be somewhere here, right? That's the center, and I'm just making it as a reference. So I am making it like minus 25. It's like minus 25 millimeters inside, almost like an inch, right? We'll follow the same rule again with the PCB, right? So we have the PCB. Let's hide the battery holder. We don't want this right now. The shortcut for assembly is J. I'll make a joint. I'll click on this center and lower enclosure. Go back here again. Okay, there we go. It came right in the center, but we have to make sure, because PCB also have some header pins going under the PCB. So we have to give some clearance always, right? So we can't make it like totally sitting on the surface. So you see these header pins? So we have to give some clearance. So I usually give a 3 millimeters height as an 3 millimeter offset. Oops, not 30, it's going to be 3, right? So this is 3, here we go. And now if I open and hide this, we have a bulb holder, we have a battery holder, we have the PCB and everything, right? And because we are making this thing, so we can't just make the objects PCB and battery holder sit on over here. So we have to have a groove, something like this on the base. So I'm going to make another sketch right on this, and we'll take the projection of these small components to have the right assembly and the fitment. So I'll go to sketch menu again and click on this. And there's an easy way, project, right? I want to project my geometry. This is called project, the shortcut is P. I'll say I want to project this entire thing and my PCB. And I click OK. There we go, and I can now hide these objects. Wrong timing. Okay. Yeah, there we go. Now we got two projections. This is the actual boundary of my other component. What I need is I want to make a groove so that this thing can fit inside. So I can't make it like exactly of the same dimension. I need to give some tolerance, right? So there's an offset command. So we click on this, and I usually give a 0.5 offset. I don't want this thing to completely dance inside the groove. I want it to be a good fit, right? If you can have used like a hot glue or something. So it should be like a good tight fit altogether. So 0.5 is a reasonably good, offset. So this is good. And I'll do it again for this PCB, 0.5. Right. Now what happens is sometimes when we create these things, we forget to make the inside geometry as the construction plane. So sometimes if extrude, you might also end up in excluding the inner one, not the outer one. So we have to carefully make it as a construction plane like this. And then you see these extra holes and all those things. We don't need that right now. So I'm quickly going to select all of this and remove it. Delete. Okay, I forgot to remove 1, 2. Make it quick. We are running low on time. There we go. Now we got this. All right, we want to have fitting, right? And obviously, we're just making one rectangle doesn't mean it will automatically fit. We need something else also, right? So I am making another offset. It's going to be of certain thickness, right? So 0.5, as I said, the rule of thumb, 1.6 millimeters, right? 1.6 plus 0.5 makes it 2.1. And then we have this. This is the new boundary. I'll do the same thing again with this. I'll select all of these, 2.1, there we go, like that, right? Just to save time, I'm quickly making it pretty fast, right? So we also want to make sure that PCB has to sit in a proper orientation. So I'm going to make offsets even for these things. So it's going to be under this. So I'm making it minus 0.2. I'm making more offsets, minus 0.2, same goes again, minus 0.2, minus 0.2, there we go, now we are good, and now we can just quickly extrude all these things, make sure to select the right one, there we go. And usually 8 millimeters is a pretty reasonably a good height. Let's see how it goes. We got this. And if you click on this, not looking bad. It's not going to be a very tight fit. There will be some tolerance. So this is a good place to keep these components, right? And we again have to make some other arrangements, right? So just to give you a quick overview, I want to show this directly in my previous design. This was my cover. This was my the body inside, right? I exactly did the same thing, right? So you see these colors right here, right? In order to make this, I did a very, very quick walkthrough for the design. I'm going to make a construction plane, right? At the top, right? I'll show this. I'll make a construction plane. It will define how much thickness I want to go in, right? So usually the top plate is going to be 1.6 again. So minus 1.6. So it's going to be the offset plane. It's just below this. And I'll make my projection right on this plane. This. And what I need is I need this specific face selection. I want this face to be projected right here. Right? Now we got this. And obviously, because you know this is a complete body, so I want to make some smart changes so I can save a lot of time while designing it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a rectangle connecting these two points, and I'll trim off the extra lines because I don't need those. There we go. And obviously it looks pretty sharp, not going with the aesthetics. So we have an option to even create fillets in the design. So I'm going to make a fillet right here. So 5 mm looks good. Let's see, what about 10? Too much. Go with 5 only. Right, so we have this. And I want to make 4. So instead of making 4, we can also think of making a pattern. So I want to just find out one center point on this line. So I'm making a reference line, and I'll select this as a construction plane. And what I usually do is, in order to find this, I just define a point by going on this line, and it will give me, I have to hide these things. It will give me a reference with a triangle that can act as a point, the center point. Okay, it looks like this. And now what we can do, go to pattern, circular pattern, and we want this thing to circle around this point, that too in a quantity of 4, and press enter, right? We also want these things again, so we want the circle. I'm going to use a socket head screw of 3 mm thickness, so 3.2 is a reasonably good hole for this. Okay, I want to make another pattern of this, exactly the thing. And then there we go. Cool. We are done with this. And now I'm going to finish the sketch, turn this on again, and I'll activate this component. And I'll just quickly extrude all these new profiles. So I want it to be certain thickness. So usually my goal is to use a 12 mm socket head screw, the way I used in my previous design. So I'm going to make it approximately 10 millimeters of the thickness of this this collar. There we go. And the operation will be joined, and we will see these things right inside, just like that, right? So if you notice, now if I make the cover on top of this, this will be right of the same design. And let's quickly make the cover also. So I'm going to make a new component because I don't want everything to just fall into this same component, right? So I make a new component. I'm going to make a new sketch right on this new plane. Okay. I don't do too much extra work, you know. I'm going to just make special entries. I'll make this projection again. Obviously, this is going to be an assembly. So everything has to have certain, tolerances. So we have this, and I'm going to make offset again. All right, so this offset is going to be inside, obviously, because this is supposed to go right in. So minus 0.5 is a very good tolerance. You make this, and at the same time, you know, we have to even make some projection for these things, these holes. There we go. And now it's time to extrude, okay? And the extrusion will be somewhere till this. Okay, this looks like my cover, right? And this is my, I'll name it like top cover. You see, we have pretty good looking feature base. I'll quickly go back to my original design. because we are running pretty much on time right now. So I'll quickly walk everyone through with the actual design, what exactly I did. Okay, I'll quickly go back. I'll activate this component. Just to show what I did, I'm going back in my original design. Okay, so you see this? This is we are at the same point right now. So I made a small rectangle cut in the center. I made a new sketch. Okay, so you see this? And then I made one new sketch, which is right at some certain height, right? And I made these small, profile as that of the LED dimension, right? So LED has a small diameter of 9 mm, and the inside is 8 millimeters. So the circle I made inside is actually 8.2. So LED can fit from backside, but it won't come out, right? This is what we want. And after this, loft. So when we do loft, we actually get this, right? We all know this. Once we make loft, I made the shell from the top, and this gets a good, reasonably good depth like this. And after this, we create the hole in the center to fit the LED. And after that, we add more and more components. So actually, you see, I imported these socketed screws from, this feature base insert from McMaster car component. Once we have these socketed screws, we have to place them at the right place, like this. And once we are done with this, in order to make a pattern for a certain component or a feature, we need to have certain axes, right? So I use this construction set, axis thing to make a new imaginary axis. So if you've seen my design, there is a small axis, right? This one, right? So that's my axis. So I created this one. And there we go. This is my pattern. You see in the timeline, this is a circular pattern for all the same socketed screws. Okay. And after this, I again imported this nut. You see right here, this is the same nut. This is M3, and the thickness is 3 millimeters. After this, I added a little fillet on this surface, and doing so, that's the overall design what I exactly did for the upper surface, right? And after that, in the end, I made these small circles. I'll quickly show how it looks. Yeah, there we go. If you see, I just made one collar, and I intentionally made that because I don't like my socket heads to just sit idly on the surface. It looks like pretty bulky, We don't want a 90-degree collar all the way, right? So it has to have a good, beautiful look. So I made this small collar, and I add a chamfer altogether to make it look beautiful. Plus, it also acts like a good stand when we keep it upside down at the rooftop or something. It doesn't scratch my main surface. Circular pattern again. We go in the end, and we have the LED in the center, right? Though in this design, we still have to put through in the center. I forgot to mention about one very important thing. Okay, so if you see this design, the first question is how these nuts and bolts are actually connected together, right? I use a simple approach. Let me hide the lower body. Okay, you see this. So this nut has to fit into some place to hold the bolt from the top, right? And what I do is I make small sliding collars like that. Let me quickly do the analysis. That will help everybody. Yeah, there we go. You see this? So from inside, you can literally slide your nuts with a screwdriver or barely with a hand. I take the projection of the hexagon right inside. I give a small tolerance. Make sure we always have to give tolerances. You put the screw, the nut inside, and then on from the top side, we just have to tie that. So it feels like this is like a regular the female screw that can hold a proper bolt. So this is my approach. I learned it from YouTube, and I see so many people do this, and this is like really handy when it comes to design for 3D printing. So this is the actual design. We have the LED in the center, and I'll quickly show how this is okay. So in the rendering workspace, I saw a few people commented that how to add glowing surfaces in appearance. There's a material called LED, or you can just also look for bulb, and you can just add that to the specific feature that you want, and then you know you are good to go. Let me show that. If you look for bulb, there we go. Frosted this, and this also comes with lumens. You can also control the lumens accordingly just to get a good graphical representation. So I designed this LED, and you see in the center, and there is a small white portion, and above that I added the actual glass, so it gives a real representation. Let's see how this looks. I'll make it this view, and it won't glow right now. We have to click on in Canvas render to see it working. Let's see. I clicked on that. Sorry for my kind of slow system right now, but it started to come out. All right, it's taking a little time. I'll just quickly show with some fast rendering. Okay, so you see, it will be blurred because I'm doing in Canvas render right now. It's consuming my computation, and I have opened like so many things in the background. So I have like limited RAM in my system, but once we render this professionally with Cloud Render or something, it will look amazing. Once we design everything, another job is we have to make these parts ready for 3D printing. So the best thing is, what we want to do is, we have to hide everything which is not non-important, right? We don't want to manufacture this. We don't want to manufacture this bulb holder or this PCB. All we want is this piece, right, and the reflector cover, right? So I usually do that one by one, right? One option is save as STL, right? Click on this, save as STL, right? Another option is go to tools, and there is an option to make 3D print. Click on this, and it will ask you what you want to make. So this is like, it automatically converted my 3D object into a mesh data. And I used Simplify 3D. It will automatically open this on my software, right? I can even add a new software, whichever I want, like Cura, Print Studio, or something I want. But you know, this thing usually works pretty well with me. So I'll quickly show if I have to open this for Simplify 3D, how this design is going to look like. I'll stop sharing and I'll share my screen again. Okay, there we go. So you see, I got, this is my 3D printer bed. I used the Ultimaker and looks pretty good, right? It barely took me time to make it, right? And we can just place the object accordingly, which can be more suited. Now I'm going to check how this is going to be manufactured. I don't want it to be 100%, obviously, because these side collars to hold the nut, I don't want them to be rock solid. 20% usually works, right? I'll make it 20%, and I'll make it like medium quality. That is like 0.2 or like 200 microns wall thickness. Let's see how it goes. Prepare to print. Let's see how much time it takes. Okay, so this says this, the weight is going to be 72.68 gram. Not bad. It's like almost less than 100 gram. And this is going to take 5 hours to print. As you see, I was mentioning about the wall thickness. So I want to give you a closer look on that. You see this line, although, wait, it's like, I think I zoomed it too much. Okay. Oh man. Right. So you see, initially it was giving the infill, and after it is completed, so we only have 4 constant lines, right? This is the thing that saves a lot of time while 3D printing, right? So whenever you make thickness to a certain perpendicular height of some object, or a wall or something, make sure give a multiple of the extruder diameter. You will save a lot of time. Well, here I end my presentation. I got like consumed like too much of your time, and I think this is the time for question and answers.
Thank you, Varun, for a wonderful explanation on 3D enclosure. I'm waiting for my 3D printer to come out this particular enclosure design, and I will definitely share.
Right. Okay. So let's go and check out the questions. So one person said, I hope you get 100K followers as soon as possible. All the best.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And one request from my side, if anyone not subscribed yet, please do subscribe to my channel. I will definitely do more wonderful projects on my future. So thank you so much for the best wishes for me.
Awesome. Okay, taking up another question. What's the largest question? PCB and solar panels is available in Fusion 360 library. I want to add to this. Currently, I don't think this is available right now, but there is also external libraries which are supportive in Fusion 360. If you want to add some external components right inside, it is possible. But for right now, solar panel, I could not find it, so I had to make a small object. So Devashish shared the dimensions with me. It was 58 by 58, right? So I had to make a small rectangle, give the extrusion of a certain thickness, like 3 millimeters, and then give some fillets on the side and add a decal to give it a more solar panel look.
It was wonderful, actually. Right. Solar panel looked really nice.
Yeah, it was looking pretty realistic. Okay, yeah. So Ahmed asked this question, how to import components like LED bulb, gears, and etc. Okay, I can answer that. So what happens is, when you have to have certain specific components, so there are certain websites which give you options to import certain tools, right? So these are like external tool libraries. I will show you quickly how it works. So you see insert, this is one McMaster car library, right? I usually use this to import any kind of specific mechanical tool. That this is like really, really a good one. So you see anything, screws, threaded joints, and all these things. We get a huge range of tools available right here, including bearings, collars, springs, shock absorbers, and everything, right? And this is really good for mechanical database. And if I don't find something here, I use insert a manufacturer part. It opens a new website part for you, and you can also search your specific component right on the website. Okay, Lalit asked this question, how did you make the deflector? Hey Lalit, I think I covered this. I made us two sketches, up and down and loft, right? I have shared this, so you can also watch my recording if you want to see basically how I made that conical reflector. Okay, so Johan asked this, is the reflector available locally? Locally, there are many ways. What happens is, I do a lot of these, playing around with bulbs and these objects in my room. So sometimes I design a small surface and I manufacture that using 3D printing and I spray paint that, right? Because LED bulb doesn't create too much heat. I purchase a paint that costs like 70 rupee or something. And that's like a super reflector paint, steel color. And I paint that and I use that as a reflector. That's like my thing. Hey Devashish, how do you manage that, reflectors and all?
Normally, I stick the aluminium foil in my project. Otherwise, the option you have given, that is the best option I have to see. But whenever spray paint is not available at my workshop, I normally use aluminium foil.
Oh, that's also good, right? Okay, Ronat asked this question, in your last step, any other software require? Yes, so for slicing, I would recommend, if you have purchased a 3D printer, usually printers have their own slicing software, right? And there are some other open source softwares also, like Simplify 3D or Cura or something like that. Okay, one person asked how to select specific types of nuts and bolts. Okay, as I mentioned, I'll do a very quick demonstration of this again, because I know this is important. When I learned this, it came out to be really a lifesaver for me. And I'll just quickly showcase that. So like if I want a M5 socket head screw, what I go do is, I go to my McMaster Kai library. I say I want a socket head screw like this. So system of measurement is going to be metric, and I want it to be M5. Okay, now this will ask me more questions. What kind of pitch I want? I want it to be 0.5 millimeters, and I want the length to be approximately 16 millimeters. Okay, stainless steel, there we go. So we have this as an option, right? So once we have this right here, we have to scroll down all the way down, and this will give me option to save in 3D step and click save. That's all we have to do. The moment we click on this, it will automatically import the tool right in the Fusion workspace. There we go. All right, I click on okay. So you see this? This is what we just imported. and this is a modeled step CAD file. Very good, works pretty well. Okay, one question is from Nini. For PCB integration, will producers mass produce our circuit or they produce just one PCB?
Okay, so earlier whenever I started actually PCB designing, in that time actually it was really difficult to get small number of PCB, but now there are so many manufacturers which produce only 3 to 5 PCB. So you can order 5 PCB at least, and it is cost very normal. I think it is around $2 for 5 PCB. That's all.
Okay, right. So they say, I currently need to integrate a circuit into a PCB, but manufacturing of a single PCB is not available anywhere as far as I have seen.
Single PCB actually getting is very difficult, but you at least order 5, I think. 5 is readily available.
Okay, Mr. Azam asked this question. This solar lamp design is will be available on Instructable?
Whatever I given in the webinar itself, it was not exactly given in the Instructable, but if you request, then I will definitely put all those things in Instructable.
Right. I think I can. You can just take out all these design and data set, and maybe just put the link or something so that people can download that.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. I'm taking the last question. We are like almost 15 minutes over time today, and okay. Will we be doing a webinar on 3D printing basics? Well, just for your information, now we are planning to do YouTube videos, right? We want to create more content, which is like more localized, so everybody can understand. I'm getting so many requests, like I closely work with, some good design and manufacturing companies, and they all request these kind of content. They all like their employees to have some good understanding of, like, you know, what's going on, what are the trends, and this maker industry is like really, really booming. They are like making some very innovative things right now. So we'll be working on more content and we'll publish this very, very soon. All right, I'll quickly go back to my presentation. Okay guys, so last but not the least, as I told earlier, we are running this, we are having a great deal altogether. This is a global discount offer right now. Anybody who wants to subscribe to Fusion 360, this is your time. You get it like for 50% off. And once again, thank you so much, all of you. Like, we had a great time. It was like a journey. I am going to celebrate this weekend, right? It was like super intense 15 days, and we got so many great speakers, great participants. If you want to reach out to us, follow our page. If you want to reach out to me, anybody of your preferred network. Once again, thank you so much. Thank you, Debashish, and thank you, everyone. I'll see you.
Thank you, Varun, and thank you, everyone.